Good morning. The first item of business is general questions, and at question number one, I call John Mason.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its involvement in the proposals for Glasgow to potentially host the Commonwealth Games in 2026.
Cabinet Secretary Neil Gray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Commonwealth Games is a hugely important event to Scotland and Scottish athletes, says a former athlete. The Commonwealth Games Federation is working with a number of Commonwealth Games associations to reset and reframe the Games. And Commonwealth Games Scotland have confirmed that they are looking at a potential hosting solution in Glasgow if an alternative host cannot be found. And that solution would be delivered using investment from the Commonwealth Games Federation plus commercial income. The Scottish Government are continuing discussions with Commonwealth Games Scotland and Glasgow City Council to further assess and develop the proposals, while no formal decision has been made as yet.
John Mason.
I thank Mr Gray for that answer. I wonder if you could go into a little bit more detail as to timescales for decisions being made, and would there be any public money going into this at all?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, President Officer. I thank John Mason for his question. The Commonwealth Games Federation have said that they intend to announce a decision regarding the favoured proposed host in May 2024. If at that stage Scotland is deemed to be the only viable option, then steps will be taken to gather additional information and assurances to enable the Scottish Government to confirm or otherwise its support to proceed. The Commonwealth Games Scotland concept proposes a significantly reduced budget in the region of £135 million, with funding drawn from £100 million of investment from the Commonwealth Games Federation, plus commercial income, and not from the public purse.
Paul Sweeney.
I think the proposal for the 2026 Commonwealth Games in Glasgow is great, and I encourage the Government to embrace it enthusiastically. I was disappointed, however, that the scope of the proposal did not include an athlete's village, which of course was one of the great legacies of the 2014 Games, and perhaps an opportunity to focus state investment might be an expediting regeneration of currently derelict sites in Glasgow already in the pipeline for development as an athlete's village, such as Cowlairs or Red Road. I encourage the Cabinet Secretary to engage with perhaps Wheatley Group and other social housing providers to look at that opportunity to bolster the proposal for a Commonwealth Games in Glasgow.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you. I thank Paul Sweeney for his enthusiasm. Obviously, there's quite a bit to consider here, not least the timescales, the public finance situation that is involved, and also that Glasgow's legacy from 2014, which, as a spectator, it was incredible. It was a phenomenal Games, and Glasgow has an incredible place within the world as a host, has a credible reputation as a host. Clearly, the timescales, the public finance has been such, the infrastructure that's already in place puts Glasgow in a good position, but the consideration that we've got to bring should Glasgow be the preferred location is obviously around timescale, around the scale of the Games and what we'd be able to offer, which has to align with what the Commonwealth Games Federation is also looking at in terms of the long-term situation for the Games.
Question number two, Paul O'Kane.
To ask the Scottish Government when it last met with Renfrewshire Health and Social Care Partnership.
Minister Marie Todd.
Scottish Government officials last met with Renfrewshire Health and Social Care Partnership officers on Thursday, 4 April 2024.
Paul
I thank the Minister for that answer, and I welcome the news on Tuesday that the Integrated Joint Board in Renfrewshire has abandoned the proposals to close and merge the Mill Day and Mirren Day centres for people with additional support needs. And I would congratulate all service users and their families for their tireless campaign to save those services. But it shouldn't have taken such intense efforts or legal action, indeed, to change the proposal. And other services are not being spared, such as Montrose Care Home in Paisley. The underlying problem remains. This Government is chronically underfunding HSCPs and slashing their budgets. So I say to the Minister, when is she going to deliver for people in Renfrewshire, especially the most vulnerable, with proper funding to avoid cuts and indeed to take action on stopping residential care charges and bringing people who have a learning disability home to their areas, as has been promised by this Government for years?
Minister.
So the first thing for me to say is that we don't want to see the closure of good quality care homes and other important care services. We absolutely understand the concern that this can cause for supported people and for their families. But decisions on how to deliver local services are for integration authorities to make, in this case, the Renfrewshire IGB. The Scottish Government expects those decisions to be made in consultation with the people who use those services and in full awareness of the potential impact on them. On the the issue of funding. The Scottish Government has invested over £2 billion in the 24-25 budget for social care and integration, delivering on our commitment to increase social care spending by 25% over the course of this Parliament, 2 years ahead of our original target. I know that discussions around the National Care Service are ongoing, but the National Care Service is our proposal to rise to meet some of these challenges. Members of this Parliament and the public want to be able to hold ministers accountable and responsible, and the National Care Service proposal will enable that to happen.
Question number three, Stephanie Callaghan.
To ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made of the potential impacts of reports that HC1 plans to terminate the contract for the hospital-based complex clinical care service at Hatterley Care Home.
Minister Marie Todd.
So, although we have overall responsibility for health and social care policy in Scotland, the statutory responsibility for delivering and for commissioning appropriate services for the community lies with local authorities and integration joint boards. We set clear standards for the quality of care provided in Scotland and regularly engage with local partners to ensure these standards are met. We understand that North Lanarkshire HSCP are working to identify a new location for the service and are conducting robust reviews for each individual to ensure the safety and care of every resident remains everyone's top priority. We also understand that HC1's managing director has offered to meet with residents' representatives and the affected families to discuss their concerns.
Stephanie Callaghan.
I appreciate the Minister's answer. The termination of HC1's outdated contract with University Health and Social Care North Lanarkshire has led to closing three of their five Hatterley units, as the physical layout is considered no longer suitable for residents with advanced dementia, and vulnerable parents and their families are left understandably distressed at the loss of their forever home. Can I ask what steps the Scottish Government is taking to monitor planned closures and provider failures at a national level so that any escalation in closures during this period of rising costs can be addressed at an early stage to ensure continuity of care is prioritised?
Minister.
We understand University Health and Social Care North Lanarkshire are working very hard to identify a new location for the HBCCC service in a comfortable and homely environment. Their overriding priority for each and every patient is ensuring their continued safety, minimising any distress and supporting them and their families and carers through this process. They are also providing support as necessary to staff to ensure that the service's patients remain everyone's number one priority through this process. Now, regrettably, there will be situations where the independent sector or local authority-run care homes close, and our focus is on ensuring that local partners who are responsible do what is required to ensure transition to suitable alternative placements.
Question number four, Pam Gossel.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it has taken to help local authorities tackle damp and mould in social housing.
Minister Paul McLennan.
The latest Scottish House Condition Survey results show that damp was present in 4% of social sector dwellings in 2022. Over £200 million has been made available to social landlords through the Social Housing Net Zero Fund, launched in 2020 to improve energy efficiency and install clean heat. And proposals for the new Social Housing Net Zero Standard include measures to prevent damp and mould. Local authorities have powers to tackle substandard housing and decide how to spend available funds. Record funding of over £14 billion has been provided to local government in the 24-25 budget settlement.
Pam Gossel.
I thank the Minister for that response. My constituent is a single mother with three children trapped in a two-bedroom dwelling infested with damp and mould. Her infant and toddler are now facing respiratory problems. The efforts to fix the problems have been shockingly inadequate, and the damp and mould still persists. I am sure the Minister agrees that this neglect is unacceptable. Reflecting on the tragic loss of two-year-old Awab Ishak in 2020, whose life was claimed by poor housing conditions, the UK Government has brought forward Awab's Law, which creates a strict guidelines to force social landlords to address damp and mould issues. What consideration has the Scottish Government given to introducing similar legislation?
Minister.
Thank the member for her question, and happy to engage with her after this to pick up the specific issue with the local authority in terms of that. And again, happy to consider the proposal that you mentioned there and discuss that and how we can take that forward.
Thank you. Question number five, Ariane Burgess.
To ask the Scottish Government what discussions the Rural Affairs Secretary has had with ministerial colleagues regarding what steps it can take to protect horticultural workers on seasonal worker visas from unfair work practices and substandard accommodation.
Cabinet Secretary Marie Goujon.
The Scottish Government recognises the valuable contribution that seasonal agricultural workers make to the agriculture sector, and that's why we're fully committed to ensuring Fair Work applies to seasonal workers. We've funded the Worker Support Centre since 2022 to provide free and confidential support to seasonal migrant workers, and RSABI provides practical, emotional and financial support to all people involved in the Scottish agricultural industry. The Housing to 2040 strategy aims to ensure that there will be no margins of tolerance, no exemptions and no acceptable levels of substandard homes in urban, rural or island communities, deprived communities or tenements.
Ariane Burgess.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her answer. The Scottish Government has committed to roll out Fair Work conditionality for public sector grants and recently confirmed that the Real Living Wage and effective channels for worker representation would apply to 5 grant schemes for agriculture, crofting and forestry. However, it's unclear when these conditions will apply to direct farm payments, which would do the most to safeguard vulnerable workers on our big fruit farms from unfair dismissals, unfair piecework payment rates and unsuitable accommodation. Can the Cabinet Secretary provide information on when Fair Work conditions will be extended to cover all farm payments?
Cabinet Secretary.
The Fair Work and the principles of Fair Work have been a key tenet of this government's policies, and they are also a key driver for achieving that sustainable and inclusive economic growth. And we believe that when it comes to public funding, that should be used to lever in wider benefits, such as the promotion of Fair Work, really to try and support the development of that successful wellbeing economy over the longer term. Now, that is why we are putting Fair Work principles at the heart of new agricultural funding streams. Yep. And specifically, we committed to introduce a requirement on public sector grants to pay at least the real living wage to all employees and provide appropriate channels for effective workers' voice, such as trade union recognition within the limits of devolved competence.
Emma Harper.
A recent report from April last year on seasonal migrant workers in Scottish agriculture found that most seasonal workers come to Scotland because working here has been personally recommended to them, and that of those surveyed, 87% were satisfied with accommodation. Does the Minister agree that Scottish agriculture needs access to the people who want to come to Scotland and make a vital contribution, and that the main route of doing so is to undo the damage of a Brexit forced on Scotland by Westminster?
Cabinet Secretary.
I absolutely do agree with that, and the member raises some important points with her question. Because Scotland is a welcoming country, we value those that choose to come and live and work here. And of course, fruit and vegetables are one of the biggest and fastest growing parts of our farming sector. And Scottish employers are increasingly dependent on migrant workers for a growing proportion of their workforce, which of course, are the issues that they're experiencing have all been exacerbated by the hard Brexit that the UK government chose to pursue. Seasonal agricultural workers play a hugely important role when it comes to filling vacancies across the agricultural sector and as well as helping the overall sustainability of our rural economy. And it's the UK government immigration policies which fail to address Scotland's distinct demographic and economic needs, which highlights the need for a tailored approach to migration.
Question number 6, Colin Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it has taken to prevent the closure of care homes in South Lanarkshire.
Minister Marie Todd.
No one wants to see the closure of good quality care homes, as I've said already. Decisions on how best to deliver services for local communities are for integration authorities to make in consultation with the people who use those services and in full awareness of the impact on them. I met the Save MacLimate House group on the 25th of April, and I have written to the South Lanarkshire Chief Officer and Integration Joint Board Chair requesting an urgent meeting to seek reassurances on the steps they plan to take to ensure the residents of both homes continue to receive the support that they deserve. As you know, the 24-25 NHS Recovery Health and Social Care budget contains £2 billion of investment for social care and integration. That represents an increase of over £1 billion compared to 21-22, exceeding our commitment to increase funding for social care by 25% over the life of the Parliament.
Colin Smith.
Thank you, President Officer. The residents of Macclimont House don't want the Minister to write to talk about assurances. What they want the Minister to do is to intervene to save Macclimont House. The IGB have made it clear to the Minister this is an entirely financial decision to plug a £33 million funding shortfall. The Minister will know this closure proposal is absolutely devastating for the older, vulnerable people who face being kicked out of their home to save just a few £100,000. At a time, it could be used as a step-down facility to tackle delayed discharge. So will the Minister intervene now? A National Care Service is too late. People want intervention now. And will she do so? And will she save this care home for the residents that face being homeless as a result of it?
Minister.
So the member will be aware that the chief officer of the IGB has written to request my intervention in this case. As a result of that request, I have met with the families who are affected by the closure, and I have requested an urgent meeting with the chief officer of the IGB and with the members of the IGB in order to discuss this closure. The most important thing is that the individuals living in that care home and their families are satisfied with that the care that they currently receive, which is acknowledged to be of an exceptionally high quality, is continued beyond whatever arrangements are made for their care.
Question number 7, Ros McCall.
To ask the Scottish Government what analysis it has conducted of its reformed dental payment system introduced on the 1st of November 2023 in the Mid-Scotland and Fife region.
Minister Jenny Minto.
We have long-standing arrangements to publish activity on NHS dental services through Public Health Scotland, and data on the reformed dental payment system will continue to be provided through these arrangements on a quarterly basis. Published data provides information at both a national and regional level, which officials use to inform ongoing, regular analysis in discussion with all NHS boards, including NHS Fife, on the impact of national reform on local care provision.
Ros McCall.
I thank the Minister for that response. The dental payment system reforms embarked upon by the Scottish Government were supposed to make it easier for people to access dental treatments. However, in my region of Mid-Scotland and Fife, latest statistics show that while around 90% of adults in Fife are registered with an NHS dentist, only around half of them have actually seen an NHS dentist in the last 2 years, widening oral health inequalities. So will the Scottish Government agree to amend the data collection of NHS dentistry to include participation as well as registration? And how do they intend to deal with the growing oral health inequalities in the region?
Minister.
I thank Ros McCall for her question and happy to look at her initial suggestion. We are working very closely with health boards on workforce initiatives because, as we were very clear at the start of payment reform, that was the first step on the journey. We are looking at things like the direct access model, and I know that in NHS Highland are keen to be involved with that. And I have also been working with the other UK nations and stakeholders to improve overseas dentist pipeline, which I'm very pleased to see is moving forward.
Question number 8, Jeremy Balfour.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it has followed the advice issued by the Information Commissioner's Office regarding appropriate governance and controls for the use of children's Scottish candidates' numbers for research in the education system.
Cabinet Secretary Jenny Gilruth.
Yes.
Jeremy Balfour.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her answer? As she will be aware, there was no governance put in place around the use of children's Scottish candidate numbers when the health and wellbeing census was run in 2022. For example, candidates' numbers are used as pupil email addresses in some schools. The ICO has advised the Scottish Government there were serious risks needing addressed that could cause potential harms for children due to the intimate nature of the data being gathered about pupils and their families. Will the Scottish Government commit to reviewing and, if found to be infringing GDPR and ethical standards for health research, commit to deleting the data gathered from 134,000 children who participated in the survey without being informed of these risks?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for his question. As he will be aware, over the past year or so, my officials have had a series of meetings with the Information Commissioner's Office on this very issue, and I understand the ICO has also met to discuss the same issues with local authorities. And as a result, the Government is currently reviewing and enhancing our own internal processes and procedures to further reduce the risks of us in relation to the Scottish candidate number for our own uses in relation to statistical and research purposes. But those enhancements are also about ensuring that we have the improved technical and organisational measures designed to more effectively implement data protection principles, and it will also ensure that improved safeguards will deliver on better meeting the requirements that are set out under UK GDPR requirements.
Thank you. That concludes general questions.